Something very strange is happening here in California right now. It's actually sprinkling a little bit. And this was unexpected. We don't know what to do. What's going on here? It's a little chilly. So this is very strange. I don't know how to react to it. Now, as far as the world goes, something very strange is going on there. Although if you recognize what's going on, you can say, "Oh, okay." You don't have a suspicious mind, actually. When you see what's going on, you say, "I know what's going on. I don't have suspicions. I know what's going on." But really, what's happening is everybody's getting these suspicious minds. Nobody's trusting anyone anymore. It's all by design. Any port and storm is the mentality that is being cultivated here in this world. So we will be willing to go into a port which we otherwise, you know, wouldn't ever go into, a port of pirates, so to speak. Just to escape the storm, we figure, well, we got no choice. And that is what's going on in this world. And it is by design. Those who have spoken about a grand conspiracy, etc., well, they're in the ballpark. They're in the ballpark about that. Absolutely. They've just left out the extraterrestrial element about this to a large extent, that they don't see that yet. But that's what's really driving it. And even beyond that is simply, it's our own arrogance that's driving the entire situation. The entire situation. What we're experiencing actually is not so much what we would say reality is, a defense against reality. This is really what we're experiencing as we are a person, we seem to be a person in a world. This is just like a dream. We're experiencing a defense that is designed to defend our arrogance. That is it. Now, if we want to, let's say we want to escape all the things that bother us in the world, well, I asked that question today. I enumerated all these different areas that I don't like, and I said, "Where can I go? Where can anyone go to escape all of this?" And I said, "Well, how about now? How about checking out now?" And I said, "What? Yeah, right now." And that's actually the only place where you can go, where you can escape all of this. The catch is, you can't go there because you're already there. And we're simply defending an arrogant belief that we can be someplace else. And so we arrive at this situation where we can't find now. I said, how do I find now? How do I find it? We can't find it. It's unfindable. We can only abide in it. We can't find it. And this is a subtle, just a play of words, but it does point to something, a truism. It does point that as long as we think that now is some thing to win, like in a contest that we arrive there before someone else arrives there, we will not experience it. It's what we experience when we drop the notion that there's anything up for grabs in reality, that there's any prize up for grabs. There isn't any prize up for grabs. As long as we see the now as some sort of prize, some sort of destination, some type of saying, "Well, I got there first," then it will elude us. We won't realize where it is. Because where it is everywhere. It's already here, everywhere. It's inescapable. As long as we think that now is escapable, we won't be able to experience it. We can't believe it's escapable and still experience it and still find it. When we say something is findable, we're assuming that we don't already have it. When we say that we can arrive at somewhere, we're assuming we're not already there. See, and these are more than just assumptions. They're arrogance. It's our arrogance is saying that actually reality, we insisted reality suspend what it is so that we could then compete with God, with reality, to see if there wasn't some other reality of our own making that's actually better. So we are presuming that somehow now has been suspended and is yet to be determined where it is and what it is and how it is and all of this yet to be determined in time, space, process, and form. So with this arrogance, we're not able to experience it because we're putting now in the future to be determined. In other words, we say the nature of reality is yet to be determined. That's, and therefore, we will not experience it. So we're going at it from this angle. And the results of that are that we continue to make great breakthroughs, but which is also very stressful, actually. And I have to remind myself that hey, just last night I just said stuff that has never been said here before. Basically, I mean, it just, you know, it was incredible, or not incredible, but it was just it's a strain. And so of course I might feel the next day feel a little down and strained and in shock. And I'm still in the wow mode. Like, wow, isn't that great that we can finally, that we're able to say this, that we're able to recognize what's going on here. Isn't it great that we feel we're getting close to being liberated from this madness? Isn't that great? From these defenses, ultimately we're experiencing our defensiveness. Actually, and I've called these defensiveness as various terms we can use. But we're oblivious to this. We think we're experiencing life. We're not experiencing life. We're experiencing a defense against life. Because if we experienced life, we'd realize we were not able to get God to suspend reality so we could compete against it and say that that reality is yet to be determined. So by experiencing this defense against life, so we're not experiencing it, presumably we're experiencing a dream, a wish, idle wish, but we feel that we say, well, we're experiencing life. No, we're experiencing a defense against life. A defense against experiencing life. That is what we're really experiencing here. Now, it's tough for us here in the Western world, especially in various places like the United States. It's such a new, well, it's not really a new country because the Indians are here for a long time. But as far as those living in this country at this time, we haven't had boots on the ground as far as saints here. I mean, there are places like in India, for instance, like southern India, and all of India, where you had like thousands of years of succession of saints and enlightened ones. You know, here among the people, giving evidence of this extraordinariness that the world is nothing like what we think it is. It's just a defensiveness. Who show us that we're only experiencing our defensiveness here, our defense against reality. That's it. And so the people there, they had this long tradition of coming in contact with that. Whereas here, like in the United States, we don't have any contact with living saints here, basically. Almost none. Certainly not this long tradition here walking among us in this place. So, and the modern generations having cut themselves off from this traditions, you know, it's tough for them to believe at all. It's easy to fall into believing that this is real, that this is life, that this is what we're experiencing is life, where in the older traditions with a lot of saints, people realize, hey, you know, this may be just like a dream. This is some, like our karma, we're experiencing some sort of karmic dream here. And we're not to take it too seriously and not to believe in it so much, and to spend time, as much time as possible, waking up from this dream. And yet, just because we claim we're naive about it doesn't change it at all. It is still, we're just experiencing a defense, defending against experiencing truth. We're trying not to experience truth. This is the price we're paying for arrogance of wanting to be greater than God. We can't see reality as it is. We have to claim that reality is yet to be determined. And so we feel we can't experience reality as it is right now. And we also claim that not only is reality to be determined, but the winner, the one who had the right idea about reality, wins all, and is the new prime creator, and the loser loses all and is annihilated. So we're trying to make this game, you know, full of very intensity to keep us working on this. And so if we experience reality as it is, we'll realize, oh, this is how it's always been. And we realized we weren't able to suspend it at all. We had no power to suspend it at all. But then by our own rules that we claim this game must be played by, we believe that then that means we have to be annihilated. So of course we're going to fear losing our defenses to defend against experiencing reality. Because of this fear of annihilation, and also a fear, a continuity fear of just experiencing reality as it is. We're so used to our defensiveness, thinking that's reality. We believe that this experiencing it is the sort of a de facto reality, although we realize it is a sort of a, we think it's a process of arriving at a determination of what reality is. And so we're so used to that. To experience reality as it is, again, is just something that we fear. We don't know what that would be like. It's really raining a little harder here. That's amazing. Well, that's good. It gives everything a little drink. Keeps everything green going. I just try to make these videos like a little spiritual drink, some spiritual rain, to keep us going in these crackpot times, really. And yet we don't need to react with anger to what's going on. It's all intentional. It's all intentional. It's all to keep this delusion of defensiveness going, that reality is something to be determined. And we believe that all of this, what's happening here, is some sort of autonomous activity, not really being generated by anything. It's self-generated somehow, nature, all of this. And it will ultimately arrive upon some conclusion, and then that will be the new reality, and then we'll determine, is that the same as the old reality, or is it a new one, the kind of thing. But we feel it's unfair to stop this so-called experiment until it's reached its conclusion. But the truth is, there isn't anything autonomous taking place. There isn't any experiment taking place at all. All of this is taking place within reality. Reality has not been suspended in the slightest bit. It's we're just insisting on overlooking this fact. Now, the more we hear this, the easier it gets for us. So we continue to go over this and over and over and over this, realizing we're going to have a backlash of wow about this, realizing we're going to pay a price. But we'll think about the price that we would pay if we continue to play along with this to be determined by some autonomous activity scenario, when in fact everything is being done deliberately here by spirit in an attempt to hide reality from itself. Trying to hide from itself. Spirit is want one with reality. It is reality. Everything is reality. And spirit's trying to hide from itself, as it were, to claim that reality is yet to be determined, which means it managed to get God to agree to a deal, to a contest, and to get God to suspend reality, some sort of suspension of it. And spirit believes that all this has taken place, when in fact it hasn't taken place. And spirit awakening realized that nothing has ever taken place. No contest was ever started. There's never been any process ever taking place. There's no contest ever taking place. No deal has ever taken place. No suspension of reality has ever taken place. So there's no momentum been generated. Nothing autonomous building towards something to be determined an outcome. There are no outcomes at all taking place. There are no situations taking place. There's no circumstances taking place. Therefore, you could say there is no world taking place. There is no universe taking place. There's nothing taking place. And this is the realization of recognizing reality as it is. And we might believe that, oh, it's just too impossible, it's too difficult. No, it doesn't seem that difficult if we really keep looking at this, like, you know, with in discipline and practice and seriousness here to get used to this. Because what is lost? We're having a contest and say the winner takes all. We already have all. So in recognizing nothing's ever happened, what do we lose? Our fear is what we lose. That's not such a bad thing to lose. Maybe we'll get a lot of rain in May. I doubt it. But one year we did. Rained every day in May one year. So we cannot turn reality on and off. So we think that we can turn reality off, and then this world that we're doing is our effort to turn reality back on, as if we're prime creator, able to turn reality on and off. Reality doesn't turn on and off. It's just on. It just is. Pure spaciousness just is. It's not a force. It's not a dynamic. It's not moving. It's not going anywhere. It's absolutely still. And so we ask pure spaciousness, have you ever moved at all? Has anything ever moved you? We're honing in on this question, that the answer of which we will take in any format that pure spaciousness wants to give to us. Pure spaciousness, has anything ever moved you in the slightest bit? Okay, so pure spaciousness, has anything ever moved you in the slightest bit? For we're really, this is progress now for us, the spiritual progress, not the kind of progress the world is looking for towards some outcome. But the progress we're looking for is to get an answer. Has anything ever moved you in the slightest bit, pure spaciousness? Have you ever been moved in the tiniest bit, pure spaciousness? Please answer that in the manner of your choosing. The answer can come in any way that you so desire. With an open mind, please give us an answer. Has anything ever moved you in the slightest bit? Have you ever been moved in the slightest bit. Have you ever been fixated in the slightest bit? Meaning, having a preference or binding an appearance. Have you ever bound an appearance ever? Have you ever fixated anything at all? Pure spaciousness. Have you ever fixated anything at all? Now, who knows how pure spaciousness can answer? I mean, it could answer in the form of some sort of an appearance, which, of course, we would be interpreting the answer as an appearance. Being what we expect, but that's okay. It doesn't have to be appearance of a person or anything. I don't know. It could just be a feeling. But we'll find out. So let's keep this inquiry to pure spaciousness, not so much an inquiry, but a friendly relating to pure spaciousness, directly like this, and asking pure spaciousness these questions. Have you ever fixated anything at all? Have you ever fixated on anything whatsoever? Even stillness. Have you ever fixated on stillness? To any fixation, has fixation ever happened? Have you ever fixated at all? Has anything ever moved you at all? Have you ever had any preferences at all? Now, these are not rhetorical questions or flippant questions. We're literally asking as if pure spaciousness is an entity that we can ask these questions to. It's not some like inert deadness. It's some sort of intelligent aliveness, awareness. So we can ask these questions of it. These are very legitimate questions. Fixated? Has anything ever moved you? Have you ever been fixated in the slightest bit? Have you ever blocked anything? Any appearance? Have you ever blocked any appearance? Now, this is a wonderful way of looking at it, and it gives us sort of an end to what we would call enlightenment, or it gives us an end to it, because the answer that pure spaciousness can give us, we'll let it be whatever it is. I don't presume to speak for it. We don't presume to speak for it, but let it speak. Let it respond. Let it respond. And the response that it gives, we can wear that, as it were. We can allow that, and because this is the response we asked, and here is the response. So we want to have this response, and we want to keep it. This is very important. So it can be something that we wear it as it were, like a coat or something. You know, like a coat. It gives us this coat of assurance as the answer. And we can just say, well, this is the answer that was given in response to my question that I asked. And just let it go with that and say, well, you can ask the same question. So this gives us a very unique way of looking at enlightenment, realization. It doesn't have to be set in traditional ways. We can set it in this context, actually. For instance, what if there was a halo or some sort of, you know, this beautiful light that was the response of pure spaciousness? And so we just let that light stay with us, because that's like a fact that we want to be aware of. We don't want to lose sight of that fact. So we just allow that fact to remain with us. And people say, oh my gosh, you're enlightened. We say, well, that's just the answer that pure spaciousness has gave me in response to my question. So you can ask the same question. And just let it go at that. It's that simple. Not complex, is it? It's like devoid of complexity. Oh, what about a beautiful aura of peace arrived as the answer response? And let's say pure spaciousness says, I'd like this response to abide with you as reassurance that this answer remains true. It's not just a flippant response. It is something that remains true. It's not changing. The answer isn't going to be changing. So let it remain with you. So let this aura of peace remain with you. So all your days here in the world, you simply have this aura of peace. That is simply the response from pure spaciousness, saying, let everyone see that this response remains steady. And this will let everyone realize how serious and adamant and true the response is, how steady it is. How that it's not wavering or flip-flopping or anything, or being suspended or anything like that. You can ask pure spaciousness, have you ever been suspended? Have you ever been fixated? Have you ever been moved? Have you ever been suspended? You know, so the response can be a living response, because pure spaciousness is the ground of livingness, as it were. So it's not like an image, it's a livingness. So it's not just an image, it's a livingness. So the response, we could just have this living response and just say, wow, this is the response that I got from pure spaciousness, and put it all in that context. There's a beautiful context to put it into. I really prefer this context over any of the others that I've come across. It's just it resonates with pure simplicity and non-conceptuality. And I say, hey, yeah, but this living response, I can get used to this response. It's hard to believe because we've been believing, assuming otherwise. But the longer I stay with this living response, the more I'm convinced that it is true. And ultimately, then I can drop all arrogance and pretense that it could possibly be otherwise. And then others in the world can come upon this, and at least they get a glimpse and say, hey, maybe I could get a response from pure spaciousness. If pure spaciousness responded to you, it might respond to me. Now, of course, the arrogant ones will say, well, yeah, it responded to you, but it doesn't respond to us. You're special. It's, in other words, it's fixating upon you. That's what they will say. And that's their arrogance speaking, you know, their fear speaking. But the quality of the response, maybe it's a non-fixating, you know, quality to it. So they just pretty much would have to overlook it. Just say, I'm not going to pay any attention to that. But that's the wages of arrogance, is you don't pay attention to the evidence that indicates that the arrogance is non-causative. You keep believing it's causative, and the outcome is yet to be determined. It's like arrogance, you know, says, well, there's no causation yet, but whether it's causative or not is yet to be determined. And then that locks you into this delusional dream of time, space, process, and form. You believe that reality is yet to be determined. This is the damnation of arrogance, is you feel bound to this and bound to the rules that you set up for this arrogance, that the you know, winner take all, loser is annihilated, and that you must wait for an outcome. Of course, the outcome that we're waiting for is an outcome of causation for arrogance, which never occurs, actually. But we keep believing that it does. Because we're always waiting for an outcome that never happens. That's pretty frustrating. So, I really, this is, we brought up here in this video, this new context for realization, enlightenment, etc. And let it be simply a response to our query that we made of pure spaciousness. And it's a living response. It doesn't die. It doesn't end. I mean, if that's what it is, if pure spaciousness, how it responds, we'll find out. But it could very well be that. And so then we just happily say, oh, wow, I'm great. I like this response. That's wonderful. It's a wonderful response. And people say, well, you're blessed. You're very blessed. Well, no, I just have a response that I asked for a response. And this is what it means is pure spaciousness responded. They might say, well, how come I hasn't responded to me? Well, you haven't asked. Again, we're so frightened that the loser is annihilated, that if we see that arrogance has been non-causative, meaning pure spaciousness has never been moved by it in any way, never been fixated in any way, never been suspended in any way, we take that as losing, that proves our arrogance is non-causative, and we think then therefore by our own rules we've made up that we have to be annihilated. But keep in mind that it's not up to us to make up the rules of reality. God has already done that, and we can't change the rules. So there is no such thing as winning or losing. There's no such thing as annihilation. You cannot be annihilated. We are reality. It's to say that we can be annihilated. It's just saying that reality can be annihilated. What we're saying is, like, if reality turns out to be real and unchanged, then reality has to be annihilated. That's what we're saying to ourselves. Because we're saying that it has to be changed. We have to have the power to change it. Only the way that reality can survive is if we actually change it. Of course, reality being all one and perfect as it is, to change it, the only change that could happen would be an annihilation. So basically saying either we get the outcome of annihilation or reality has to be annihilated. So either way, we're looking at annihilation with our arrogance. Our arrogance literally gives us a picture, an option of annihilation or annihilation. That's it. So of course we're a bit perplexed and fearful and have this inner dread. Choice of annihilation or annihilation. To win, we have to annihilate ourselves, reality, and in order to win. And if we lose, well, then we have to be annihilated also. All reality has to be if we lose, we're annihilated, but we are reality. And if we win, God has to be annihilated, which we are God too. We're annihilated also. So annihilation. So we're trying to choose between annihilation and annihilation. That's a choice that arrogance gives us. And so, of course, we're come up with all sorts of silliness that we say is helping us make the right choice. And we have all this fake wisdom saying, yeah, I think I'm making progress in finding the right choice here. And, of course, we're assuming that there's some right choice that yeah, this is the one we want. We're choosing between annihilation, and then believing that one of them is what we really want and the other isn't. And so we need to work really hard to get the one that we, make sure we get the one we really want. Whereas actually, they're both exactly the same options. So there's no difference at all. And yet we're desperately trying to see differences between those annihilation and annihilation. And we have a life here, existence, and we think, oh yeah, I made a lot of progress in my life. I really feel that I was able to. But deep down, we feel like, you know what? I don't feel like I've really made any progress at all towards, I'm failing. It's terrible. I mean, if I don't succeed, I might pick the wrong one. You know, it's scary. It's like, I can't tell the difference between annihilation and annihilation. And it means I have a 50-50 chance here. If I pick the wrong one, I'll be annihilated. So we keep thinking, no, I don't want to choose yet. I don't want to choose yet. I got to keep working on differentiating between the two. I wonder why we're frightened. Especially this comes up when we want to be finished with all this nonsense. They say, okay, I got to choose now. I got to choose. And then we feel like, oh my gosh, how do I choose? This is scary. And then we realize all our learning we think we've learned was just a bluff. We think we're so smart, and then we get down to trying to choose between the options that arrogance gives us, and we say, I can't recognize the difference between the two. Wow, that's scary. That's terrible. What's the matter with me? How could I be so stupid? And then to believe that there is a difference between the two of them that we can discern, we use the defense of total mental chaos and say, well, I know there's a difference somewhere. I just can't. It's so chaotic, I can't figure out where it is, what it is, what it could be. Instead of recognizing that there's no difference between annihilation and annihilation. We're just actually, there's just one outcome of our arrogance, that possible outcome. The only possible outcome of our arrogance is annihilation. There isn't two outcomes. There couldn't, not two possible outcomes of it. So there isn't really an option at all. So there isn't a choice at all. So why are we trying to use total mental confusion to make it seem as though that there is an option and we can discern the difference? It's just that we're so confused we can't do it right now. Hiding the fact is a way of hiding the fact that there isn't even an option at all. If arrogance was causative, the only option is annihilation. And since this is so, and we're not annihilated, since we're still worried about choosing between these options, the supposed options, that means it's not causative. And if we say, we could say, the annihilation is coming. Eventually it's coming. But that means we have lost to God, and reality hasn't been suspended at all. And reality is all now. So how could our annihilation be in the future, something to be determined? See, that doesn't fit at all. That would only be the case if we would have won. See? But and if we would have won, we would say that annihilation doesn't exist, and therefore we wouldn't fear it. It's something like this, but we're just looking at this, that the fact that we're here now means that certainly God didn't lose. So if God didn't lose, how can we win? So we're forging into this. I have you know, we have to get a little clearer about this, and I haven't worked it through all the way through yet, so that's fine. What's important is to see that there is no, actually, there aren't any options. The only outcome of arrogance is annihilation, if it was causative. So keep in mind, when you're going into real deep territory like this, you might try to elaborate on it a little bit, and then if you feel a little clumsy because you're not, you know, it's kind of doing something you haven't done before. Well, that's expected. It doesn't bother me. Just fine. You just don't struggle with it. Sometimes excessive elaboration is a defense in itself to distract us from the wow of how far we've come here. The wow is that, you know, we're bringing this to light, and it's obviously, this is the whole structure of delusion is coming to light now, and we can go back to asking pure spaciousness for its response to our questions. Yeah, okay. Have you ever been suspended? Are you suspended? Have you ever been suspended? Have you ever been fixated? Have you ever been moved? Have you ever been changed? Have you ever been disturbed? Have you ever been agitated? Have you ever been turbulent? Have you ever been angry? Have you ever been fearful? Have you ever been doubtful? Have you ever been stormy? Now, the response could be multifaceted, too. It could be a living response that gets better and better and better, or reveals new and new facets to us. Absolutely, it could. It doesn't have to be an image. Again, it doesn't have to be an image. It could be a living response that just becomes richer and richer and richer and richer and richer in its assurance to us. That's very possible. So we've gotten into the wow here. I feel the shock of clarity here. What if we did get a response? It's this sort of feeling. Wow, what if this actually works? And then we can help this out by saying, yes, I already know that I've already gotten the response of pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that I have already gotten the response of pure spaciousness. And to assume and to feel as if it's already responded. It's a fact that it's responded. Assume this fact and rehearse this fact, the assumed fact. Yes, I already know that I've already gotten the response of pure spaciousness to my questions. Yes, I already know that I've already gotten the response from pure spaciousness. Yes, I already know that pure spaciousness has already responded to my questions. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing the response of pure spaciousness to my questions. Yes, I already know I'm already experiencing the response of pure spaciousness to my questions. the non-dualist might say, well, who's experiencing the response or something? And you can get tripped up in some ways if you go like that. But I'm just looking at that, and, well, it's just yet to be determined. But once I get used to this response, I would say, I guess I'm one who can ask and receive a response on pure spaciousness. And it's up to pure spaciousness to determine what I am ultimately, right? So I can't say that I know for sure until I'm completely comfortable and familiar with this response. So it's not that who I am is yet to be determined. It's who I am is present, but I need to get used to it. That's different than to be determined. I feel it's been determined who I am, but yet I need to get used to it before I can say with any, you know, certitude. Certainly the ego will try to trip us up on this. And it'll give some kind of faux non-dual questioning. You know, who's experiencing this? You know, kind of trying to knock you off the experiencing. And I say, well, the experiencing is happening. Why do we need to ask, you know, who? You know, turn around. Well, who is it that wants to know the answer to this question? If someone's asked, you know, who's experiencing this? Well, who wants to know the answer to this question? Turn it around that way. Right? And I say, well, look, instead of asking me questions, go ask pure spaciousness questions. That's what I did. And they said, well, who's this I? I said, well, find out for yourself. Why don't you find out, ask pure spaciousness whatever questions you want to know the answer to. Don't ask me. Find out for yourself. Ask questions and get the answer from pure spaciousness. And of course, being, you know, fearful to do this, trying to get you to answer this question, which really rightfully should be asked of pure spaciousness. And as far as trying to give someone, you know, to tell us what it's like. Well, it's a living response, you know. If it is a living response, you cannot put it into an image. That would be misleading. Because then they think, oh, he got a dead response. Because he says it's like this. You know, it's easy to nice excuse. You know, they're looking for excuses not to ask. Based on this whole dynamic of arrogance where we brought the light, feeling that they would lose if they get a response, that the response might cause them to feel that they've lost the contest. And again, there isn't any contest. So it's better, instead of trying to ask questions of someone, it's better to find out why we're afraid to ask questions of pure spaciousness directly. Why are we afraid of that? Or you can use whatever terms you want to use for pure spaciousness, but so it's a very different mood here with this odd weather. I don't know where this system came from. It doesn't act like a normal system at all. It's just sort of came in from somewhere. There wasn't any wind associated with it. That's quite odd. We have systems that go through here, but this just imperceptibly just sort of drizzling, and it's been around all day. There's no turbulence or wind associated with it. It just decided to rain. That's all. Everybody got caught unawares by this. I asked the postman. I said, "Hey, were you expecting this rain?" He said, "No, no." The newspaper arrived without any wrapping on it. They're always very diligent to when there's any chance of rain, they always put a plastic wrap on the paper. They didn't today, and the paper got wet. So obviously this was not anticipated very well by the weather people whose job it is to tell us. And I got caught in the rain today, got soaked. I didn't have a jacket, didn't have a hat or anything. Everyone was getting hit by this. They, what in the heck's going on? It's fine. We love it. Let it rain every day like this for a long time. So we have to be very careful that people don't make an idol out of us. They will, you know, we can't force them. They may do so anyway, but we have to reject that and say no. You ask yourself. You get your own response from pure spaciousness. And if they say, "Well, no, do we know that pure spaciousness fixates on you?" Well, how do you know? You won't know for sure unless you ask. Ask pure spaciousness. Have you ever fixated at all on anything whatsoever? Ask for yourself. And of course, those who suspect that don't trust pure spaciousness, believe that they've been able to change it, won't ask. That their arrogance prevents them, it makes them fearful. But those who suspect that this is all that arrogance is non-causative, and this is all just a dream we've made up, we're just misinterpreting everything, then they say, "Hey, you know what? Why don't we just ask pure spaciousness?" They're not afraid to do so. Because the answer won't seem like losing to them. Have you ever changed pure spaciousness? And pure spaciousness says no, you know, then the arrogant will say, "Oh my gosh, we lost. We weren't able to change it. That means by our rules we must be annihilated." So of course they're not going to ask that. They want excuses not to ask. So they'll want to work on you, saying, "Well, you didn't really ask. This is not really a response in pure spaciousness. You're lying. And try to poke holes in your story, so to speak, like that." But this is a waste of time, waste of everyone's time. So you see, there's quite a difference between those who repent and those who are not. Quite a huge difference. One will pursue a certain type of civilization, other will pursue another different type of situation, civilization, very different. What's going on in the world is like a movie. You know, it's hard not to watch it, because it's like some farce. Slapstick farce that you know, it's like the actors and actresses, their actions and what they're saying are so bizarre. You say, "It must be a movie. I can't believe what they're saying, you know, the stuff that's happening. I can't believe it. You know, this has to be like a farcical movie." Has to be. You can't know. Didn't say that. That's not possible. I mean, are you kidding me? I mean, what? It is. It's these are all actresses and actors acting out a script that is just, you know, too bizarre to believe. normal, you know, normalcy wouldn't behave this way at all. Repentance would not behave this way at all. People lying, and everyone paying no attention, you know, to the lie, and yet paying massive attention to something super trivial, you know, and someone, you know, saying, leading us into, you know, destruction, and lying about it, and nobody says anything, and then some super trivial little nonsense, and everyone is like furious and upset, and say, oh my gosh, this is awful. This is a farce. This is an incredibly farcical movie that's taking place. But we have something even better than watching that farcical movie. But it's good to laugh at it. You know, in a farce, the audience is supposed to laugh. And so we should be laughing. Remember that these actors on stage, they're getting all this attention, and you know, they're actresses and actors, and they are intentionally saying this ridiculous stuff to make us laugh. And we're forgetting to laugh. We should be laughing. And of course, they act like all affronted if you know laugh. That's part of the movie too. Is that it's supposed to make you laugh even more? He said, you know, he said, what? She said, what? Are you kidding me? I mean, you can't even make this stuff up. It's so off the wall. It's so crackpotted. Absolutely crackpotted. Basically, they're saying, you know, anyone who has any sort of peace of mind has an unfair advantage and over others who don't. Therefore, they have to forfeit their peace of mind for the sake of those who don't have it. In other words, any lowest common denominator, anyone experiencing anything other than absolute lowest common denominator has an unfair advantage over those who are, you know, on the bottom. So we all have to be on the bottom together to make it fair to everyone. And when we see a farce, we know it's a movie. Then we think it's hilarious. But we say, oh, these people are pretending to be insane. This is very funny. I think we'd like to view this movie of we're pretending to be insane. You know, it's like really a bizarre movie. But it is just a movie. The ideologies I see are just so hilariously insane, you know, that it's like saying nobody has a right to even remotely turn towards pure spacious and ask pure spacious for a response. We must all be adamantly 100% convinced that such a thing is impossible and live with the consequences of that as our beingness. And anyone who doesn't take that position has an unfair advantage over those who do. They're unfairly happy. It's unfair to be happy. It's unfair to be sane. Of course, the insane are going to say it's unfair to be sane. It puts us at a disadvantage. But keep in mind that insanity is actually arrogance. It's a defense of arrogance. Where arrogance is trying to say that it's better. You know, that we're better than reality, that we can tell boss reality around. So all insanity is based on, it's actually sheer arrogance. Who are we to say that what God created can be insane? What God created to be perfectly sane, that can be insane? That's just nothing but sheer arrogance. So it's just a play of arrogance. See it that way, and you're not so intimidated by all the guilt, that the guilt trip that they're trying to lay on everyone. Guilt tripping, you know, it's taking place. Ego tripping, guilt tripping. I mean, there's so much ego tripping going on now. It's just astonishing. It's reached, you know, preposterous proportions. You know, every day you keep thinking, everyone's going to come to their senses. You know, they're going to finally get off this ego trip. It's so preposterous that you can't possibly continue on. And then the next day they end up topping it. You have to kind of applaud to say, "Oh, wow, that's great. Didn't think you could do it." How astonishing. They're even more preposterous. Instead of saying, "Hey, to those who are doing well, I'd like to do well too. Let me emulate that. Well, how is it, you know, how is it that they're doing better, and what kind of beliefs do they have, and or ultimately, how can I do the best possible? Can I experience what I really want to experience? Let that be the question." Well, because what we're really saying is, "Hey, I'm not experiencing what I really want to experience, and someone's preventing me from doing this." Well, how do I experience what I really want to experience? Can others interfere with that? That's the course of question. So instead of questioning the whole guilt trip and the whole victimization scheme, you know, people are continue to say, "Hey, you know, I'm being victimized. I'm being prevented. I'm being, you know, I can't get what I really want." Is that true? What if what we really wanted was an answer from pure spaciousness? So, what we really need to do is everyone needs to start asking questions and say, "Hey, wait a minute, what do I really want? And how do I really get that?" And so I have an answer for everyone here saying, what we really want is we want a response on pure spaciousness. And the way to get that is to ask pure spaciousness. And should we get a response then from pure spaciousness? And what, pure spaciousness, is there any way to block your response? Can you be blocked in any way? Can pure spaciousness, can you be blocked in any way? See, there's another question. You see, if we're absolutely free, how can anyone say that they're not getting what they want? How can I say? So those who claim that they're not getting what they really want, they're really claiming that they're not free. And this is, again, sheer arrogance. So what they're really saying is, I'm not really enjoying sheer arrogance, and it's up to everybody else to make me enjoy it. Well, what if you can't enjoy it? What if it's not possible? What if it's not true? What if your arrogance is totally non-causative and therefore has no feeling to it whatsoever? Can't be experienced. How can anyone help you experience what can't be experienced, which doesn't exist? So you're just pulling them down into arrogance as well. But how is that freedom? If we're perfectly free, we're free to not be pulled down to arrogance. We can choose to not be pulled down to arrogance. So the whole scheme of the ego doesn't add up at all. It really doesn't. And all the ego can do is insist that it's everybody else's fault that it doesn't add up. Somebody's fault. Wait a second. If something doesn't add up, then how can it be someone's fault? Again, if there's only one option, as we said, with arrogance, which is annihilation, there's not two options. Then say, it's not fair. I can't figure out, you know, which one to pick, and it's someone's fault that I can't figure it out. Well, this is absurd, isn't it? So the problem is that no one in the world is really willing to say that absurdity, and just say this is absurdity. This is absolute absurdity, and that's the answer. You know, this is what we're doing in the world is absurdity. So that there isn't any further answer to give, and we say there's only. Arrogance only has one option, and that's not an option. If arrogance could be causative, it would be annihilate itself. It would be, so there isn't anything to choose between. There's no better option than that. So to say we're having trouble discerning what the better option is, it's like, hey, I need better education and better upbringing and better this and better that, because I can't figure out, you know, which option to pick. That's utter nonsense. It's absurd. There isn't any option to choose. There's no options to choose between. There's no choosing, because there's no options. There's just, if arrogance was causative, it would be annihilated. Of course, we say, well, it's yet to be determined if it's causative. This is how we keep playing this game. But in order for that to be so, reality would have to be suspended. So the question is we need to ask, hey, pure spaciousness, have you ever been suspended? Are you suspended now? Or have you been fixated? Have you been touched, moved, you know, changed? Have you been changed in any way? Have you been suspended? You know, find that out first before we assume that there's something yet to be determined. Find that out now. Find that out now. So, okay. Well, it looks like someone is saying it. Looks like it's being said that dinner time. Okay, we reached an hour, and that's probably as much as you can take right now. Very great. We're still on track, and let the wow happen. Let's not think about it too much here. I think there's enough thinking, because the wow of just, hey, we can ask pure spaciousness, that's enough, and we know that this will give us the leverage, and we won't be bullied around by arrogance. So, okay, very great. This is, again, I didn't feel like taping today, so I'm so tired. I feel so despondent. And to know, it's like getting up in the morning, you got to go to work. You don't jump out of bed and feel great every morning. A lot of mornings you say, hey, I don't even think I can work today. But you say, I got to work. I have to work. So, and speaking of work, what's going on? I realized today that it's very likely what's happening in my life is I'm trying to undergo punishment, sort of like preemptive punishment, for it's as if I'm going to be inevitably punished and subjected to slavery, so I might as well get used to it. So this is what the goddess told me. Her wretched advice is that, yeah, you know, you're going to lose. It is, you know, you're inevitably going to be pushed down into, you know, a slave class, and you'll be, you're going to just be on the bottom, and so you might as well get used to it, and then the only way you can be happy is just to resign yourself to your fate and get used to it, and therefore you won't suffer so badly when it actually occurs to you. So you might as well get a jump on it and get in advance, and see, you're being smart that way, and that's the only way your smartness can really play out, is to put yourself in a super lowly, terrible position, because that's the one that I'm going to assign to you. The goddess says, anyway, when I gain power in this world, so I'm help. The goddess says, I'm helping you out by letting you get used to it ahead of time. So I'm really engaged in something just like that, as if this is the position I'm going to have to endure once the goddess gains control over this world and planet. The goddess defense. It's just a defense, actually. And so then I already feel accustomed to it, you know, and it won't be like such a terrible blow to me at that time. But what if none of that's necessary? I say, hey, wait a minute. This is very odd. This is assuming that the goddess defense it inevitably gets control over me. What if it doesn't? Then all this assuming a low position and suffering is totally unnecessary. It's like, what have I been doing? This is like crazy. It's like, wow. And I saw it in this way. I'd never seen it in this way before. And I just said, holy cow. I may be just suffering preemptively, putting myself through this, assuming that I'm going to be forced into this at some point against my will. But I said, hey, wait a minute. That may not be true. Maybe this whole goddess thing I've seen is just a defense against fear. But I'm working this defense out, and I realize I don't need this defense. So then I certainly don't need this preemptive trying to accustomize myself to punishment and condemnation in the future. So there's a little light at the end of the tunnel suddenly. I saw a light at the end of the tunnel. Maybe I'm not going to be bound to this work forever. Because to me, it's like crazy. What am I doing? I said, what am I doing? I don't want to be doing this. I should be sharing truth with everyone. You know, this is nuts what's going on. And it's actually part of this defensiveness, actually. Okay, so that's just a parting thought to say, hey, wow, maybe there is a light at the end of the tunnel. All right, very great. We don't know what's next, right? I'll keep asking. Pure spaciousness. We'll keep asking. Give it a try. At least consider it. Give it a try. Consider it. Okay.